Hello, everybody, and welcome to another Freethinker interview, this time with Paul Bloom. He's a renowned scientist, speaker, author, and teacher of psychology. Welcome, Paul.
Thank you for having me here.
Great. And you study and, you know, talk and write a lot about morality, pleasure, and religion. These are topics that are very exciting to our group. And your latest book was Just Babies, The Origin of Good and Evil. And I just love the title. It's so clever. It's one of the best titles that I've ever come across. And I've come across a lot of clever titles. Can you tell us a bit about the title and the book itself?
I really appreciate that. My wife thought up the title. I thought it was totally brilliant.
Yeah.
Not everybody gets it. It's a play on words. There's just babies, meaning only babies. But there's also just babies, meaning justice in the sense of justice. So just babies, moral babies. And in fact, that's what the book is about. It's about the origins of morality. It's about moral capacities we're born with and what we have and what we don't have. And so it talks a lot about research done in the baby lab at Yale that my wife actually runs. And then it goes on to explore questions like, how do we get from our limited innate moral sense to a more advanced moral capacity?
We live in a predominantly Catholic society here in the Philippines. And when you ask the question of where morality comes from, the most common answer that you'll get is it comes from God.
So as you probably know, there's polls out there where you ask people about whether you need religion to be moral.
Yeah.
And most people around the world, and I imagine where you live, say, absolutely. Without religion, you're a monster. There'd be nothing showing you right and wrong, nothing keeping you from doing horrible things. Without belief in God, you cannot be trusted. In America, people say that they would not elect an atheist to be president. They would elect an African-American, of course, a woman, a Muslim, perhaps a homosexual, but an atheist, no way. And as you might imagine, I don't think that that's correct, that there's a lot of evidence that atheists are every bit as moral as non-atheists. In fact, the atheist countries of the world tend to have people who kill each other less, rape each other less, are just kinder in every possible way than the more religious countries, like the ones that you live in or the one that I live in. And also, I think more as a scientist, we could ask the question of, there's a lot of morality that seems to be built into us long before we get exposed to religious beliefs or religious teachings.
Yeah, so it goes against, you know, the notion that we are, the Catholic notion that we are born with original sin, you know, that we need to be saved from that, you know, the notion that, you know, of Hume, that we are a slave of our passions, and you have a more optimistic view of humanity.
I do. It's optimistic in two ways. There may or may not be original sin, but what there is, and in fact, some religious teachings talk about this, there is a moral capacity, a sense of goodness from the very start. That doesn't come from God, I think, but also comes from natural selection, that we're social creatures, so we are born with social capacities, including the capacity to be kind to others, to judge good behavior and bad behavior, and a motivation to be, in some way, in some small way, make the world a better place. So I'm optimistic in that sense. I'm also optimistic in that I'm a big believer in the power of reason and rationality and intelligence. And I think that this is what takes us from our admittedly limited moral sense and makes us full-blown moral creatures. So we have the built-in capacity as a starting point, and then our intelligence and rationality takes us further.
I definitely agree with you on that. The notion that you could teach rationality to improve that innate moral sense that we have. And we kind of got involved in some controversy when we asked the Department of Education in this country to remove from their vision statement the clause God-loving. You know, initially they wanted every citizen to be God-loving. And, we of course wanted that removed, you know, to focus on the more rational ways of raising children. So when it comes to raising children and students, do you think religion is on the whole good for that?
So I don't really. It's as you can imagine, a very difficult question.
Yeah.
I'm an atheist myself. I don't think religion is central to morality. I think it's quite clear there are many cases we could think of where religion makes people much worse. It causes them to dampen their intelligence, dampen their better aspects of themselves, do terrible things. You know, on the other hand, I could think that in some cases, religious training could have a good effect. Some religious teachings are the sort of teachings that a secular person would agree with. I think the ritual of religion, I think the social aspect of religion are very powerful. And, you know, so religion is can go in either way. So there could be good religious training and bad religious training. I would insist it's not necessary. I mean, I raised my kids without any religion, and they've turned out pretty good kids. But at the same time, I wouldn't want to say it's always bad.
You also said in one of your previous articles that God is an accident. Can you tell us a bit about that? Yeah.
It's a controversial title. It's not one I thought up, but I kind of like it. I don't really have much to say about whether God himself is or isn't an accident, or in fact, whether or not he does or doesn't exist. But the article wasn't about that, at least. The article was about why do people believe in God? And there's different theories of that, including the theory that belief in God is a biological adaptation, that we've evolved to believe in God because God believers did better at spreading their genes than atheists in the past. And so there's an innate predisposition to believe in God that exists as an adaptation. I don't think that that's true. I think that belief in God is an accident. It's an accident because we've evolved other capacities like tendency towards animism, to see agency in the world, a tendency towards dualism, to think of the world as composed of physical bodies and immaterial souls. And because of this, it becomes quite naturalist to believe in an immaterial, moralistic God. And so I think the origins of religion aren't a specific adaptation, but arise as an accident.
Despite these tendencies to believe in God, do you agree with what Lawrence Krauss said, that religion could disappear in a generation?
Well, anything's possible. But no, I don't. I don't think that's very likely. I think religion scratches an itch. It scratches many itches. And the itches aren't likely to go away. I'd like to think that certain aspects of religion that are pernicious, that are evil, will go away. But certain aspects of religion are just central to people's lives, to their identity, their rituals. I mean, I'm not religious myself. I'm an atheist. But I have family members who are Jewish, and they do Jewish ceremonies, like the Jewish New Year and Jewish holidays, or certain things they eat and things they don't eat. Catholics go to church, of course. They have the sacraments. They have baptism and certain styles for weddings and funerals. There's no way that's going to go away in a few generations. It's too caught up in the way we live our lives. I mean, so barring some sort of horrific totalitarian government, a lot of religion, I think, is here to stay.
If it does eventually disappear, would you think that it would have a net positive effect? Or do you think, that it would be somewhere in the middle?
I don't know. Maybe one way to think about it is in terms of different aspects of religion. So when we talk about religion, it includes a lot of things. So if the religious rituals were to go away, I'm not sure it would have a net positive effect. These mean a lot to people. They add a lot of pleasure to their lives. Ways in which, and to some extent, they're actually, I think, psychologically beneficial. Like when somebody dies in Judaism, there's a certain ritual of sitting Shiva, which is for like a week or so. The whole family gets together, nobody works, there's certain things you do. And I think this is actually an intelligent way to handle the grief of the death of a loved one. And so I think we'd lose something if something like that went away. I think we'd lose something if certain rituals in Catholicism and Islam went away. So that I'm not so happy about necessarily extinguishing it. Then there's religious belief. A belief in an immaterial God, in miracles, in immaterial souls. I think those beliefs are mistaken. And to the extent I'm right that they're mistaken, I'd be very happy to see them go away. I mean, the world is not better when people believe things that are false. It gets in the way of all sorts of things. And so my feelings are then that you know, much of religion I think is good or harmless, but the beliefs can be bad. And I also think the sort of affiliation can be bad, the sense where religions are at war with one another. And, you know, and they see people who don't believe their faith are worse. The worst people in the world from the standpoint of many religions are people who leave the faith. People want them dead. And that's, I think, terrible. And that I'd be very happy to see go.
I agree. And certainly from the perspective of someone who lives in a very Catholic country, religion seems like it's here to stay for a very long time. But something that, you were saying?
So what do you think? Would you be happy if tomorrow Catholicism disappeared?
I would be okay with it, you know, as long as it wasn't done coercively, if people weren't forced to do it and they naturally just figured that, you know, they can keep the community aspects of it, but as you said, lose the harmful beliefs, I would be fine if Catholicism, especially the conservative kind, went away.
So we agree. I mean, some of the most horrific totalitarian institutions of the last century tried to obliterate religion by murdering people, by forbidding people to practice their religion. And that's I think, humanity at its worst. People should be free to do whatever they want, as long as it doesn't harm other people. But I think what we share is a wish that people would just, by their own free will, give up some of the worst aspects of certain religions.
Definitely, definitely. And I'm an atheist myself. Maybe you thought...
I would have guessed it, yeah.
Yeah. And that's something that I want to ask you about. You know, we can't convince people that losing religion is a good thing. You know, that would be very hard, or to lose it themselves. But at least to start accepting people like us. So especially in conservative countries, how do you think that we can get, we as non-believers can get conservative people to accept that we're here and we're good people?
You know, it's a really good question. And if you asked me a few years ago, my answer would have been different. A few years ago, I was talking to somebody about Richard Dawkins, and I was complaining. I was saying that he's so upfront about it. He's so aggressive. Lawrence Krauss as well, for instance. And this is just turning people off. This is not doing any favors for atheism. But I actually think that what happens is that the even the aggressive people, it starts, people become aware that this is a possibility. They become amenable to sort of people who are atheists but maybe less aggressive. I think on the whole, it becomes positive. I mean, one analogy I think about, one thing that changed my mind is about gay people in America and many other countries where the attitude towards gay men and women have changed dramatically. In my country, at least, where it used to be gay would be the worst thing in the world. And it was just, you know, people hate, tremendous hatred. But now things are changing. And I think things are changing in part because many gay people have asked for gay marriage. Very radical things. And people say, that's horrible. Don't ask for so much. But it has a positive effect. And I think the analogy to somebody in 1980 saying, not only should gays not be discriminated against, we should be allowed to be married. The analogy to someone like Richard Dawkins or Sam Harris or Christopher Hitchens saying, look, we're not going to sort of gently say, let us be atheists. We're going to say, you guys are wrong, you religious people. And then I think it has a positive effect in the long run.
I actually agree with you on that. I agree. I think people tend to accept the middle. And the further you can push the boundaries so that the middle is closer to that, I think it's definitely a good thing. And of course, there's a multiplicity of messaging that you can use. There could be the good cop, bad cop. And it's working quite well for Catholics right now with, you know, Pope Francis and Lombardi and all that. Yeah, so when it comes to...
And I think that's right.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
I think somebody like Richard Dawkins is the bad cop. he's aggressive. He criticizes people. But it opens things up for the good cop. And I think atheists benefit from both the sort of conciliatory people, the mellow people who respect others and who are polite, and the kind of people who are in your face, who are very honest about what they see as the moral and intellectual weaknesses of religion.
Yes. And we've talked about the differences of the good cop approach with the bad cop approach, but let's talk about now about the differences of a free thinker with, let's say, a bigot, you know, a conservative versus a progressive. What's the difference in psychology, do you think?
I mean, the words conservative and progressive get used in a lot of ways. So the sort of person I would think that is the right sort of person to be, who I want my children to be, I like the term free thinker. And now, a free thinker might turn out to be politically conservative or socially conservative. They may think, look, I've thought this out, and I think that the best system is one that is as we have it now, or as we had it 100 years ago. So to call somebody a free thinker, as you define yourself, and I'm willing to define myself, I try to be, isn't to say I hold a particular view. It's more of a particular style, that you're open to argument, you're open to evidence. You're not immediately prone to hate people. You know, to be a free thinker means if somebody comes up with a really good argument for God, you would listen. I'd like to think I would listen too. I'm in favor of gay marriage and gay rights, but if somebody came up to me with a good argument against it, I would listen. And I think that is always better to be. And it's very hard to be. People like Jonathan Haidt and many others have pointed out that to be rational and reasonable is extremely difficult. And everybody congratulates ourselves at how well, look how well I'm doing at it. But you know, to others, we might seem bigoted and narrow. We have to keep our minds open as much as possible. Not, you know, open, critical, but still receptive.
That's an excellent definition of what a free thinker is. And I'll quote you on that. I hope you don't mind.
Not at all.
And we'll get to Jonathan Haidt in a bit. But before that, I want to talk about how free thinkers react to farts. Because you did a funny experiment on this. Can you tell us a bit about that experiment and the other very interesting experiments that you've done in your career?
So I'm interested in a lot of things. And one thing I'm interested in is the role of the emotions on our moral judgments. So I'm interested in doing a lot of work now on empathy, arguing that empathy actually can have some bad effects on our morality. But the studies you're mentioning have to be discussed. And the arguments that we made, and this actually, you know, John Haidt's done some work on this before we did. My colleagues and I find that if you make people disgusted, it makes them meaner. It makes them more judgmental. And even if the disgust is by something which is external to the situation. So we did some studies involving a fart spray that makes a bad smell. That makes people meaner. Jonathan Haidt did some work with a filthy room, you know, and so although I think I'm very much in favor of rationality, I think there are times when we're very much not rational, and it's worth knowing this so we could learn how to deal with it.
The outcome of that experiment, of course, was that, you know, the more close-minded people tend to be disgusted more easily, right?
Well, so what we find is that we did some other studies that what I just mentioned was sort of an experiment where we got people. We didn't look at different types of people, but you're right. We did other studies looking at the relationship between how easily disgusted you are and your political ideology. I wouldn't quite frame it in terms of closed-minded, open-minded, but what is true is that in America, political conservatives are more easily disgusted than political liberals, and we and other scholars have found that as well.
And on the issue of conservatives versus liberals, Jonathan Haidt highlighted in a recent event the representation of conservatives in your field, right? Like they're underrepresented. So how do you think this came to be? And do you think this problem should be addressed? And if so, how?
So that's an interesting question. I have sort of connected this in a different way, which is that I'm the editor of the journal that Jonathan Haidt and his colleagues are going to publish an article in on exactly this topic. And the journal is Behavioral and Brain Sciences. And one of the exciting things about this journal, which makes it unusual, is that people publish articles in it. And we get all of these commentators usually disagreeing with the article. And then the authors get to respond. And I have a feeling that this article by them is going to be one of our more controversial articles. I think that I don't know why there are more liberals than conservatives in social psychology. I'm very convinced that there are, that liberals are very overrepresented. I don't know why, but what bothers me is, and this is the point that they make, is that I do think that there's a discrimination against political conservatives in our field. Now, when it comes to politics, it's not clear. Disagreement isn't necessarily discrimination. I can say, I think your views are silly and argue against you. But I think people, even when the issues have nothing to do with politics, get discriminated against in social psychology. And so in that way, what's interesting is the liberal people, who we might want to talk about as being most open-minded and free thinkers, have turned out to be as narrow and not a free thinker. So I don't know why we got ourselves into this problem. I don't know what the solution is. I don't know if there is a solution. But one thing I try to do in my own work, my own views are kind of standardly academic liberal in many ways. So one thing I try to do is I try to treat others with respect. I try to be receptive. If I have a, I'd be very comfortable with students who have different political views than I do. I've had such students. I'm not religious myself, but I would have no problem having a student who was very religious. And I have had students who were religious. So I think I try in myself to inspire that sort of attitude, and I expect to find it in others. And so I think that the article by John Haidt will have an influence, and that will get people to think about you know, their own sometimes lack of open-mindedness in the political and religious domains.
Yeah, so not all liberals are free thinkers, as you define.
Not all liberals are free thinkers, that's right.
Yeah. Your work also touches on the issue of racism, right? And in our country, there's this phenomenon called Pinoy pride or Filipino pride that really gets to me. It kind of annoys me a lot, actually. What do you think is the link of racism and nationalism?
It's complicated. So racism is bad, right? We know everybody, by definition, everybody says racism is bad. But what's bad about it? Well, you say you should judge people based on who they are, not the groups they fall into, not the color of their skin. But then again, when we're nationalists, we also judge people by the groups. We say, you know, look, I was born Canadian. I'm proud of being Canadian. Well, why is it okay for me to say I'm proud of being Canadian, but not okay for me to say I'm proud of being white? Why is it okay for me to say, oh, I don't like, you know, I don't like these people from this other country, but horrible for me to say I don't like these people of this other race? Well, there's all sorts of answers. One is that racism has a very, very ugly history. So being proud of being Filipino may bother you, but it's not as the same thing. It's associated with the ugliness of racism. I think from a psychological standpoint, we break the world into groups. I fall into a lot of groups. You fall into a lot of groups. We feel connected to our group, and maybe we don't like other groups automatically. Sometimes I think this attitude is okay. So I think it's okay, for instance, to feel closer to your family than to other people. I think a person who didn't treat their mother or father or brother, sister, or children as special would be weird. It's very unnatural. I think some of that's okay. On the other hand, I think racism really is wrong, that's the wrong group to do. And this goes back to what we were talking about reason. Given that we know that we're sort of categorized the world into groups, now we could use our intelligence to sort of figure out which categorizations we're proud of and we're willing to sort of focus on and keep, and which ones we should try to reject in ourselves and in our society. So racism and nationalism might have a similar psychological basis, but you could treat them differently and you could choose to keep one and reject the other.
Yes, I agree. And nationalism is certainly a tool that is used particularly by politicians. And we have a lot of that politicking going on in preparation for the elections. And relevant to this, you wrote that politicians really are big babies. So can you tell us a bit about why politicians really are big babies and why do you have such a negative view of babies?
You think that by saying that would be very cruel to babies.
Yeah.
This was in an article that I wrote, which I think you might be the only person who's ever read. But the claim I made was that the sort of breaking the world up into us versus them that show up in politics, and in all politics, liberal politics, conservative politics, you know, our president, United States, Barack Obama, is a Democratist liberal. But when he gives a State of Union speech, he talks about how America is better than other countries, how it's important to care about Americans first, and so on. And the point of my article was that there are studies done with very young babies before they turn, before their first birthday, showing that they also break the world up into us versus them. They prefer people who look like themselves, who sound like themselves. They prefer people who like the same foods as themselves. And I think that this sort of nationalism, the roots of this nationalism, come from psychological mechanisms that are present pretty much once we're born. And in that way, politicians, in that way, all of us aren't big babies.
Speaking of politics, a lot of people can be apathetic towards politics because they think that it doesn't apply to them, that it doesn't really apply to their everyday lives. And at the same way, I mean, in the same way, a lot of people think that psychology is something that should be reserved to the experts. But you have a very different view of that, of course. You think that psychology affects everyone. You teach everyday psychology. So how do you apply, you know, what's the most common or easy way that you could teach someone to appreciate psychology in their everyday lives?
It's a good question. I mean, I'm in psychology because I think it's the most interesting field of all. Now, as I'm a psychologist, I do research in a lab. It doesn't make me any better at dealing with people. It doesn't make me a better parent or a more convincing at selling people or a better friend. But I think some understanding about how the mind works could make your life better and more interesting. Everyone who has kids would benefit from understanding the science of what kids know and what they don't know. Anybody who deals with a world involving prejudice and racism and nationalism, it helps to understand what's going on. I mean, in some way, if you're in a country and you don't know anything about economics, you don't know anything about inflation or unemployment or taxes, you're not going to understand the workings of your country very well. There's going to be a lot that's just over your head. If you're in a community and you don't understand fundamentals of social psychology and the basis of evolutionary psychology, how our minds have been shaped by natural selection, and illusions of reasoning, the work that Danny Kahneman won the Nobel Prize for, and a long list of things. If you don't understand that, you're missing out on the world. I think psychology in that regard is 100 times more important than economics because psychology is our interactions with those we love, those we hate. And knowing how this works, looking at everyday examples and exploring them is just rewarding and I think very fulfilling.
So would you say that someone who knows a lot about psychology would have an advantage at using an app like Tinder? Or, for example, you know, because you do research on stuff like universal attractiveness, right? Or what gives people pleasure or what people like. So what do you think, you know, to start with practical psychology, what are some Tinder tips, do you think?
Oh, God. I have to ask you, I sort of know what Tinder is. Is this for dating?
Yeah, the dating app. Like you swipe left if you don't like what you see or, you know, or what you read, and you swipe right. And then if you're a match, the app connects you. And it's quite popular, and a lot of Filipinos are into that. So, you know, any Tinder psychology tips?
Well, okay. So I'm been a happily married for a very long time, so I don't actually use these technologies. I guess what I would say is that I have no tips to offer, but somebody from a psychological point of view who is interested in this should actually look at the research. So in fact, there's a book called Dataclism written by the guy who started OkCupid, which is a dating site. And he's looking at what attracts people to other people, what sort of picture gets a lot of reactions and everything. What sort of statement gets people to write in, who likes to date who, and so on. I think if you start looking at the world from a psychological point of view, you say, look, I'm not going to trust my gut. Rather, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at the data. I'm going to think hard at human psychology and try to use that. So I never, you know, because I became, you know, because I've been married forever, I have never had to do that. But when I had kids, as a psychologist, I was able to look at the data over raising kids, and it didn't make me a better parent, but what it did was it helped me realize that most of what people were saying was just nonsense. People make all of these claims, and I realized that's ridiculous. I don't have to listen to that. So as somebody with a psychological state of mind, for any problem you go into, a dating site, parenting, getting a job, fighting racism, fighting crime, you could start using psychological data and psychological research and psychological ideas to do a better job of it.
Okay, it depends on how you look at it, but from a cynical perspective, you could see the using psychology to better get people to do what you want as manipulation, right? Or even if you use it very well, it could be akin to brainwashing. You know, so what do you think are the ethics of doing this? I mean, if you're good at psychology, you know, to the point where you're like the character from The Mentalist, where you can easily read people and get them to do what you want. You know, what's the ethics of using psychology?
In everyday life, it's not such a real problem because psychology is not advanced enough so that we can actually use it in that powerful a way. I know some wonderful research psychologists, and they're absolutely terrible at life because their technologies, their ideas don't connect to life very well. Maybe I'm one of them. I think there are ethical issues that do arise. So one issue, for instance, is that in America, there's been controversy over the use of torture by the military, for instance, and whether psychologists should agree to be consultants for torture, because they might have some ideas on how to make torture effective and useful and powerful. And there are real ethical issues. In my own work, I have sort of ethical issues in a mild way, in that I've done a lot of research for a while, years ago, on why we like different things, why we get pleasure from different things. And I'm just interested in this intellectually, but these techniques can be used as part of marketing. Marketing is not inherently evil, but marketing can be evil. You could have a product that's evil. I mean, I presumably wouldn't want to work for a tobacco company selling cigarettes to teenagers using the techniques of psychology, because I think that would be a misapplication. So I think that in the cases where psychology really can make a difference in people's lives, these ethical problems do arise, because if they can make a good difference, they can make a bad difference.
So speaking of ways where you can make a very big difference, there's the internet. And you mentioned in your research that compassion expands, you know, it expands to the extent that your circles of compassion expand, right?
Yep.
And theoretically, the internet is the tool that connects us to the most number of people, the biggest audience. And it should, in theory, also expand our compassion. But people can be also so mean on the internet. You know, you have trolls, you have people who bully, who harass others. So do you think, you know, internet as a whole is a tool that enhances compassion or that subtracts compassion?
It's a good question. My answer about the internet is kind of very similar to my answer about religion, which is you can imagine aspects where it can be both. So in some way, I think the internet, you know, for both of us, for everybody, almost everybody I know, it's transformed their lives. The way I live my life now is so different from how I lived it 20 years ago with regard to teaching and interaction and so on. And you talked about it expanding the circle of compassion, and it really can do that. It can give me contact with people I wouldn't otherwise have contacted with. Let me see perspectives I wouldn't otherwise have perspectives of. It can, I think, help with people who are due to geographical accident or some sort of personal situation, lonely, isolated. If you're the one kid in a high school somewhere in the middle of nowhere and you have no friends, you may be able to find people like you on the internet, and that could be life-saving. I teach an online course. I teach a course on MOOC, on Moralities of Everyday Life. And, you know, a lot of the people who watch the course are people in New York or New Haven or so on. But I get emails from people in Afghanistan, in Nigeria, in small parts of China that are very far away from any other university. The internet makes this contact possible. So there's huge possibilities that we couldn't have imagined 20 years ago. On the other hand, as you quite pointed out, the internet, because the internet brings people together, people are often terrible to each other, and it offers possibilities for cruelty. And what's worse is, although we can't typically physically harm somebody on the internet, the anonymity, the distance, seems to make it a lot easier for people to be cruel to one another. There are things that people say to each other over email or over Twitter or Facebook they would never say to anybody in person. You know, these guys sitting in their basement in their pajamas typing these nasty emails to people, you know, and they would never say this to somebody in person. They it's like being behind the wheel of a car, you know. You feel invincible, you feel. And so I don't doubt that I think on balance, look what we're doing now. I mean, we couldn't have done this before. We could talk on a phone 20 years ago. But now, you know, this guy from New Haven, this guy from Manila, just talking about stuff with some shared interest. That's amazing. And I think the amazingness is much better than all the crap we get. But there's a lot of crap. I agree with that.
We're about to end this interview, but you mentioned your Coursera course. We'll add a link to the description here. Is there anything else you'd like to invite our audience, you know, or let them know about any projects you're working on right now?
Thank you. Well, if you go on my webpage, you could follow me on Twitter because it's social media and that's how we expand our circle of compassion. But I'm writing some papers on empathy and some other issues and just, you know, I love to correspond with people about these issues. So people, you can go to my webpage and read some of my articles. A lot of them are written for a general audience. And I like to be able to continue the conversation with as many people as possible.
Great. Lastly, only like last week, the results of the first ever board examinations for psychologists and psychometricians came out. So the first ever board exams for them happened in October. So there's a new batch of first ever certified psychologists and psychometricians. And what is your message to this new batch of psychologists in the Philippines who've reached this milestone in their careers?
I guess to go back to what we were saying, to keep an open mind. To not let your own presuppositions and prejudices and biases trap you. And, you know, so as they work on problems like education and mental illness and making it a better world, look at the data. Don't just trust me. Look at the data. Be prepared to recognize, as I've had to recognize many times, that things you really believe are just totally mistaken. And so, you know, fitting my discussion with a free thinker, that's the way I would go.
Thank you so much, Paul, for doing this interview.
Thank you for having me here.
And have a great day.
Great. You too.